Here's our last video of chapter 2. My hope is that we have fewer videos for the next units. I'm going to still keep them short, but fewer. Here we're talking about the cognitive model. And we're going to be focusing primarily on what happens here. So what happens in the mind? What kinds of beliefs, assumptions, and expectations do we have? And in particular, what kinds of distortions in the ways that we look at the world are playing out? So these are ideas that both Aaron Beck, who you see here, and Albert Ellis have described. Aaron Beck talked about the cognitive triad, which is this the kinds of beliefs that people who are depressed frequently have in terms of how they view themselves, how they view their current situation, and how they view the possibilities for the future. We're going to want to be paying attention to how do people think. In terms of change, we're also going to be looking at self-efficacy, which is another kind of belief. Can I do things? Can I make things different? I think that every movie is about therapy. I'll probably talk a lot about movies this semester. You'll see the ideas of self-efficacy in the movie Dumbo. Dumbo doesn't believe that he can fly, even though he's quite able to do so. He doesn't believe he can until he's holding this feather. Think about how his beliefs either allow him to fly or prevent him from doing so. What are your beliefs? How do they help you or not? We have another kind of ABC chart, different perspective. You'll notice that the A, Bs, and Cs, you know, look similar but are somewhat different. What we're looking at primarily here is what beliefs do people have. The way most of us look at our moods is that we think that these activating events cause us to feel and behave in particular ways. So this person might say, Marcus made me feel this way. It was Marcus's fault. And what we would argue, what I would argue, is that Marcus did not make this person feel this way. It's in fact the belief that this person responded, what's wrong? When is he coming? Maybe Marcus is upset with me. And here's the important piece. If there had been other kinds of beliefs, there would be another kind of consequence. So maybe if instead this person had said, Marcus is late, I wonder whether Marcus is okay. I wonder if the car is broken. It would have been a very different kind of consequence. Here's another example. Dr. Jones asked to speak to me after class. What did I do wrong? I wonder whether she thinks I shouldn't go to graduate school, and becoming anxious. What if instead, you know, this person had said, I wonder whether, you know, Dr. Jones thinks I did said something particularly good today. You know, in both of these situations, the person is doing some mind reading, and we don't know whether that mind reading is accurate. We're going to spend a lot of time talking about these thoughts throughout the semester. And what you'll see, and I'll have a longer version of this posted in chapter 5, but what you see is that different kinds of thoughts are associated with particular kinds of disorders. And what I would suggest is that people need to learn how to to change these thoughts, change these cognitive distortions so that they don't cause themselves problems. The cognitive behavioral model pulls together both the ideas from the last video and this video. So for example, Sean is flying on an airplane, has a stomach virus, and associates feeling sick with flying. Classical conditioning. That, you know, that causes a fear that drives avoidance behavior. You know, we don't like feeling sick, and so we avoid that. Notice the role of these thoughts. What if I get sick? Now, Sean then avoids flying, takes the bus instead. There is some negative reinforcement. Avoiding flying reduces that fear. Remember, negative reinforcement increases the probability of the behavior by removing some sort of aversive stimulus. So let's think about the cognitive behavioral model and what works and what doesn't. There are a lot of good things to say about the cognitive behavioral model. It is a pretty well-developed, well-researched, research-oriented model, really looking at outcomes. Psychologists like those sorts of things. So it makes some really strong recommendations about treatment. Pretty good effectiveness rates. You know, the cognitive behavioral model looks pretty well at outcomes under certain kinds of therapies. It doesn't do so good at identifying why, you know, some kinds of problems and not others. So, you know, but in general, this has a lot of support. This semester, we're going to be thinking about abnormal behavior from this multidimensional point of view. Under most circumstances, we're going to be looking at all of these issues, not just one, but the role of each of these. And in general, we believe that the more we understand about all of them, the better intervention we can make. So please, don't think about which one is best, but think about how they work together. I showed you this figure earlier. Remember that we can think about panic disorder in terms of some of the biological influences that may lead to panic, and there are certainly a number of things that people with panic disorder, some biological issues that play out there. What kinds of behavioral influences, to what degree is that reinforced? You know, to what degree is there avoidance learning here? In what ways are we seeing our thoughts influencing this? And if we're thinking, oh no, I'm dying, which some people with panic disorder do believe, then you can imagine how that might cause greater anxiety and panic. And also, what kinds of social influences? How do Judy's friends and family, how do her doctors and principal respond to her? So what should you do now? I would begin to monitor your own beliefs, especially in strongly emotional situations, anger, depression, fear, anxiety. What do you notice? What kinds of things do you notice? Do those beliefs help you or hurt you? And in general, we're probably not very aware of those beliefs. Later in the semester, I'll talk about some ways to help you change those beliefs. And you can, and life will be better when you do. If you haven't taken the post-test yet, do so. We're going to be looking at risk and prevention next. Take care.